Well, thanks so much for being here. I wrote a little introduction. I'll try to ad lib it, but just in case you're still wondering why you're here and why we invited you, and then any visitors, let's see, we have Dr. DeBolt, Karen Marcus, just so you kind of know how we work with this kind of open forum. So VMDO has a long tradition of holding 1 hour a week for this open discussion period where we can bring up, anybody can bring up a topic or a format, and we kind of take that time and that space to talk about our passions, look at topics that we might not get to dig into on a typical project process timeline. So it's really an open format. And with this fall series, we were asking ourselves, what do we really want to learn about? What are we feeling like we know very little about, but we kind of get a sense for? How do we design these spaces that really enhance digital engagement? Obviously, they're physical and digital environments. It's super complex. It's a broad topic. And we don't often have time or the right processes to collaborate with technologists, educators, students to kind of tweak those spaces and get them at least somewhat right or ready to be utilized in the most prototypical way by you guys. So we came up with technology as a broad topic. And so a couple of things I wanted to share just from the design side, and then we'll launch into learning from you. So in addition to not having that affordance of time to work with experts like yourself, we're really looking forward to this, you know, sitting back and listening to the projects you're working on. And as Dr. Bragaw said to Dr. DeBolt, you know, clients push architects and architects push clients. And so I think we get along really well. So we need to be pushed and we need to understand. And one thing that we've all been thinking about is how much technology is more than a simple reality for young learners, that it's really the way that they navigate identity, they interact with and co-create emergent information systems or connections. They redefine social habits and ways of creating intimacy. So we have a hunch that there's more we can do as designers to respond to these opportunities, not just the positive side, but also the needs. Kind of the backside of what technology might be doing for younger people. And so we're really interested, and we have a sense that there's a little more we can do to respond in that area. And then we also have a sense that more and more as designers and architects, we're being asked to come up with these cool maker spaces and all kinds of digital enhancements. But we really need to get better about how we collaborate together. So often our technologists or consultants on the AV side come late, and we're all trying to catch up and understand what the best solution is, when really we want to be in a place where we're aspirational and not just reacting to having to solve a problem. So because we also have a hunch that there could be a less measurable kind of psychosocial impact, like a price to pay for what has been called the coarsening effect of digital media, so challenges in the area of civic and civil discourse, the ability to empathize and sympathize, having a real sense of social connectedness that doesn't always translate to community engagement, and positive forms of social cohesion. So there's the pros and cons of moving forward in this area. And so while we know there are many positive opportunities for learners of all ages because of technology, we're aware that loneliness is actually something that's on the rise. And the majority of youth use technology as a way to hang out versus geek out. And so 10% of youth use technology to geek out. They get in there and make stuff and hash and remix and create new things and enter new worlds of imagination. So what kind of spaces will help you have more kids geeking out? So we have this hunch that the learning and work environments we co-create need to respond to both of those measurable and immeasurable qualities of technology. So that's kind of our snapshot from the design side. And that's why you're here, to help us understand from your perspective and your expertise and passion in this area. So we're going to start with Dr. Bragaw. Then we'll move to Sidney Griffin. Becky Fisher will share her work. And Laura will round it out with what I think is the best way to segue into an open discussion. It's really the hands-on, boots on the ground, teaching with kids every day. So we'll start with Stephen, and thank you very much.
I'm Steve Bragaw, and I teach at Briar College, and we just finished a project where we did 16 classrooms, around 10,000 square feet of a total room at around a $640,000 budget, half of which we got from a matching grant and half of which we raised from donors, alums of the college, donating for an individual room. And these were spaced over four buildings, one which was a sort of an early 1960s style science building. The other three were historic buildings that were designed either by Ralph Adams Cram or were in his style or from his shop back when the college was built in the early part of the 20th century. The project came in, no instructional use time lost to construction. We did the construction in the summer. So we spread it out over 2 years. The construction and installation deadlines were met, and the project was finished on time and on budget. So what I wanted to share with is a little bit about how we as and the group that was managing this project. I was leader of the project, and we had a group of faculty together with our information technology people. People from our physical plant come up with how do we solve this problem and approach it in this way. Okay, so a little bit in terms of the challenges that we're dealing with, we're a small residential liberal arts college. We have about 700 students. We aspire to really, our infrastructure is really for about 800 or 900, so we're trying to add students, but we really don't want to get that much farther north than that. So the idea here isn't to build a sort of a very vast complex, but rather to kind of do something which is redesigning, but touching the sort of the soul, if you will, of a small traditional liberal arts college. There's a historic architectural core that we're going to talk about in a minute and see, and that this was part of the president of our college, who had come to us after starting the Knightley Foundation, which is the National Institute for Technology and the Liberal Arts. And so she was, technology and digital sophistication, as she called it, was a core feature of what she wanted to do for her strategic plan. And so therefore we're going to use this as a mini campaign as a run up to the silent phase of an actual campaign to show donors and the board in particular what we could do. And the chairman of the board of our directors is Paul Rice, who many of you know, has a lot of technology initiatives over at UVA with the Rice building and whatnot. His daughter is an alum. And so he was one of the people we wanted to make sure we were doing a good job for. So the goals that we wanted to do, I set out pretty early that we were going to have certain musts or goals that were kind of built into what we were doing. First and foremost is we wanted to build space that reflected the identity of the college. We wanted to get something which people would feel comfortable in, that build space that one of our engineering people said, we want to build space that human beings want to be in. Right, so we want to pay attention to light, we want to pay attention to setting. If a student is sitting in the class in the classroom and they look out the window, is what they're getting outside the window clashing with what they're getting inside the room? In other words, to kind of create that sense of continuity and vibe. We also wanted to build space that students were going to use. They have 168 hours in a week. They're in classes for maybe 10 or 12. What are these rooms being used for the other 150 something hours a week? Is this room, we're a small campus, the buildings are open at night. Are they studying in them? Are they using them? Are they using for breakouts? Or is this just sterile, empty space? Sort of the 1960s, you know, urban space, you know, plaza that's not used for the rest of the week and therefore is not inviting. We want to blend form and function, representing the ideal of digital sophistication. In other words, the sort of the goal that we're trying to do is create space that reflected this idea that technology is transformative about education, but technology has always been transformative about education. We had faculty members who were saying, we don't want technology in the classroom. And so I'd say to them, okay, so we can build a classroom for you with no electricity, right? We'll put some whale oil lamps in there. Maybe some, you know, it's good enough for Darwin. Maybe it's good enough for you, right? No, no. And what they meant by no technology is they're only comfortable with the technology that when they were in school, right? And we're saying, no, it doesn't work that way. For students coming into to college now, good wireless is kind of like hot water. It's not negotiable, right? Good space is not negotiable, right? And so really to kind of be able to capture that because it's crucial to our enrollment. The last important part of this is we wanted to build spaces that donors would want to fund. Part of the secret of this project was finding 16 donors who could fund the back half of each room, knowing that we could count on a couple leadership people for some key things, but be able to spread out and fan out and to do this in a relatively quick fashion because the matching grant we had was on a short schedule. So the challenges that we had, that I knew we had going to this. First of all, we'd say this and I didn't realize it was gonna be recorded, but hi colleagues. High maintenance faculty used to a high degree of input, AKA herding cats. Now there's a way to herd cats, which is you open up the can slowly, right? You get them to have that good whiff and you walk with them, and you kind of lead them towards the goal. When others, we had particular key goals that we would have to meet. There was one group in particular that was being really kind of difficult, and they were supposed to have, you know, we had to come to consensus on a particular room by a particular date. They didn't do it. And so I got to go and tell them with a smile on my face, we missed the deadline, you're in the next round. And when it came time for the next round the next year, they were so cooperative, right? So in other words, kind of create this sort of sense of shared expectations, but at the same time drive that schedule becomes the key to this. We need to be able to figure out a way to do good project management without a lot of experience on campus for on-campus based project management. And we need to gain student support and input because we are a very small school. So a few students who are really opposed to what you're doing can tip the bucket in the wrong direction. We also, things that I also knew that we didn't want to do. We didn't want to lose the opportunity that you get every 30 or 40 years to really refresh a building. And you didn't want to be the guy 20 years from now, people were saying, that damn Bragaw, whoever did this project, how did they do it wrong? We also didn't want to stop, you know, thinking about tomorrow. In other words, technology is very transformative right now, but at the same time, you can see how quickly things are moving. We didn't want to build something that was the great space of 2014 and 5 years from now, let alone 15 years from now, is really a problem. So in terms of how we think about the wiring, how we think about how the room's laid out. We also didn't want to try to be different than who we were, right? This is part of the secret of this, is embrace who we were, small residential liberal arts college for women. And we wanted to do it in learning as we were going along. So in other words, do it in stages. We knew we were going to have to do it in stages to not lose any time for instructional use, because these are some of our core classrooms, and to do a 360-degree review involving faculty, students, and more importantly, the staff at each stage. What did we learn? Build in changes, a lot of small things to make the final rooms that much better. Now, what did we not want to do? We talked to a lot of alums when we said, you know, we want to build these digital classrooms of tomorrow. This is what they were thinking of, right? The bridge of the enterprises, yes, the original enterprise, and this is, of course, mirror, right? This is the alternative bad universe, you know, bearded Spock universes. This is not what we wanted to do, right? We have these beautiful, our college is regularly ranked as one of the most beautiful campuses in the country. We have these beautiful Ralph Adams Cram buildings and Cram style buildings. How do we go to fix that? So what I proposed and what we wound up doing was dividing the project into sort of three levels. The core of what we're trying to do is that you have the guts of the room, which is the wiring. And this was mainly the concern that the IT people would have in the physical plant. Where's the electricity, right? Part of what we have to do is get more sockets in there. How do you do that? In other words, try to figure out this nature of what the wiring of the room is going to be. And for us, it also included what type of controlling system. We settled early on Crestron, the Cylon brain. And so how is that going to go in, right? And so recognize, keep that conversation going, but recognizing faculty and students didn't care about that. The rig, this is the media projection integration solution dimension of the problem. Faculty would be interested in this to the degree that you would get the smart board versus no smart board war. But the real key for here became, where was the rig going to be placed? I.e., where would be the rack, where the computer, where the Crestron brain, where the VCR, not the VCR, that was a whole separate thing. The faculty, oh my God. Yeah. People still want to use VCR. We had to say no to that, sorry, right? But where was that going to reside? in some of these smaller historic classrooms. And the third dimension, which was the one which I thought was superficial, but the students and the faculty really cared the most about, which is what we call the trim, which was the look, feel, aesthetics, the paint, the chairs, the table, the whole thing. So some of the solutions we came up with this. We developed faculty design teams. We did very extensive surveys, how people were using technology, identified the people who used it the most, tried to learn from them, identified the people who used it the least, tried to learn from them. Was it because they just wanted not to use it? Was it because they didn't know how? One of the things that we discovered was that faculty, when they wanted to use it, they wanted it. But when they didn't want it, they wanted it to disappear, right? Particularly at a small residential liberal arts college. So that was going to be one of the challenges which we figured out how to do. We use social media, and particularly Pinterest. Pinterest is a powerful tool for vetting out the, you know, voting on chairs. What do the students use the most in the room? The chairs. If they don't like the chairs, they're not going to like the room. So we had this huge vote on the chairs, which turned into a very popular and useful thing. We learned a lot about the thing. And this element of kind of learning from it as we were going along. So these are the three of the historic buildings that we were working in. Two of which are CRAM buildings, and one is in the style of CRAM. And what we came with, this is the after. This is a smaller lecture room style. If I go back one, this room we're showing is right here off of this balcony. And the solution in the larger, or in this type of a lecture room, was we built a table at the front, a cabinet, which the rack recesses in, document camera, right, the Crestron pop-up is here, the wire cabling housing, there's a built-in computer with the keyboard, the mouse, or anything like that. But when you didn't want it, right, it disappears, right? And then in style of the room, there's whiteboards on this wall. There's a wall right here that you can see over here with whiteboards. There's the portable whiteboards in the back. And we use short throw projectors, touchscreen smart board projectors, which solved the smart board war, because then when you want it to act as a smart board, you activate it from over here. When you just wanted it to be a projector, you could deactivate it. So the smart board thing is very contentious among a lot of college faculty members. A lot of college faculty believe smart boards as being something which is an elementary school solution. And as the smart boards are increasing in sophistication, there's lots of ways that you can use them, but there's still this built-in prejudice to them. So the short throw projector solved a lot of there's a lot of light coming in this room. It has that sort of wonderful access to the balcony that we wanted to preserve. They use it in the summer. They do Shakespeare out there. That's kind of the balcony for it. And so this is how we approach the smaller lecture rooms using this model. And there's four rooms that ultimately had that model. Seminar rooms. This is in the solution here that we're very proud of. I took these pictures yesterday. It was a little bit cloudy on a warm day because this faces out towards the mountains. The president's house is down here. You see these windows. In the afternoon, students flock to study in this room in particular because the afternoon when the sun's setting, it hits the laminate of the wood and the room glows. It's got this honey glow, which I had a hunch was going to happen, because you could see a little bit of it in the old table, but the old table was this kind of crappy, beat-up table, but it would still get this nice reflection off of it. And so in the afternoon, this room just totally lights up, because the way the light comes in from that exposure, we did a thing in particular that this is right where the English department sits, and so I mentioned that sort of high-maintenance faculty, right? We could let them vote in particular, and we spent a little bit more in these rooms. There's three of these rooms with the little higher end chairs, and the students love it, and it fits the aesthetic design of the room. One other thing that we did in here, this is the room with the technology closed up, pop-ups for electricity, the pop-up for the Crestron access, the Crestron controller sits there, but the Cylon brain is in the base of the table, right? The pillar of the table has the rack where the Mac Mini is, where the DVD player is, where the Crestron unit is in there. It's accessed through a cabinet, which is right underneath. And so if you want to put a DVD in, you just have to kind of slide your chair back, open up the cabinet door, slide it in. But it hides it away, so it's not sticking out of the walls. When people want the technology, it's there. They can pull out. There's a drawer there for the document camera. On the wall right behind here is a short throw projector
on a whiteboard. There's another whiteboard running through along this wall right here. But that when you don't want that, you close this up, and it's just a classic residential college seminar room that reflects the setting on the outside. Okay, science lecture rooms. This was also difficult because this room was a room with that type of staging. This was a room without. And so, of course, the faculty wanted the room that didn't have the staging to have staging in it, and they wanted to take the staging out of the room that was in it. These are fixed location chair or tables, so these have electricity in them. These are movable, right? So one of the rooms has the powered tables, except for the ones in the front row for ADA access. You can move them so someone can come in, but the ones behind them are a fixed table. They have fold-out tables, so if people want to fold-out skirts, so if you have the group work and people spin around that way. This both of these rooms have two sets of the short throw smart board projectors on them. There's different chair selections, one coming more out of the chemistry department, one more out of the biology department. Each of them has a controlling table, which is different than the other ones. It's the more the science table. It fits certain different types of criteria. Everything can be put away if they're doing chemistry or whatnot that are on the table at the front. So the principles of the project ultimately were trying to capture the aesthetic of the college, right, the small residential college, to create a highly sophisticated technology in rooms that reflected their historic settings, and also be rooms that people just wanted to be in, and that donors would give us money for, and the donors responded beautifully, and the students are now in these rooms all night. Some of these rooms, they're hosting informal Netflix parties. They are studying in them. They're using from them for different things. You come in and there's all sorts of stuff on the whiteboards for people studying and people writing poetry and different things. These are rooms that were previously not occupied after class. Students wouldn't think to study in them or just want to hang out in them. And now they do, which is what, when you're in a small liberal arts college, is the vibe that you're trying to create. And that's what we were able to do. So thank you.
What kinds of tools are students bringing into those rooms as far as mobility and how do they interface with what looks like a high-tech solution?
They're using lots of things. They're using increasingly tablet and phone-based situations. And so, as well as laptops, obviously, and so part of the integration of the project, the guts part of it, was making sure that the wireless capacity, the wireless bandwidth capacity in the room, and then the ability to project wirelessly from tablets through the projectors was there, and that is there, and there's a sort of means of control, so someone can't sort of randomly hijack the projector. But it's a sort of a very powerful thing that you can use as the instructor, that students can, you can have them do. It just makes a sort of seamlessness for presentations. It's a very useful way of doing that, particularly as they increasingly think and interact with the handheld devices. Rather than the laptops
that
the space
utilized. So thank you, Dr. Bragaw. Keep his presentation in mind. Think of that young woman that just graduated from college. She's going to work somewhere. Where will she want to work?
Yeah.
I sure hope so. But we want to make sure that the space she's going to be working in will reflect her ideas about technology and how she likes to express herself. So, a little bit of background. I jumped into this presentation kind of haphazardly. We were talking about what this Design Thursday was going to be about, and I was like, wait a minute, what about the workplace? Mm-hmm. We are working in this most of our lives, and we have lots of technology here, and us as VMDO, we should be reflecting what we are actually designing in our spaces. So. This brought on a whirlwind of research for my part, but I'll start with what I know from the K-12 studio. You know, the moving dots. Ooh, ah. We were talking earlier about the liberal arts classroom. This is it. Teachers in the front, students are all facing forward. Everyone's listening, no one's talking. Well, thankfully we are going away from that. And we are understanding that there are multiple ways of getting students to learn. In this particular scenario, the students themselves are starting to become teachers in these smaller group sessions. And it just enhances the learning experience so much more than just having the teacher who A, maybe has to manage the students. As long as the students are behaving, they still have to be taught. Hopefully they'll learn at the same speed. This is another diagram that I found that we had that expands further the idea that the education doesn't just happen in the classroom. The education happens outside the classroom in all kinds of places. And these are the kinds of ideas that our projects are now reflecting a lot. We're winning awards for this kind of thinking, where the entire building, it's not just the classroom, it's the corridors, it's the stairwell, it's the cafeteria, every place has an opportunity to have a place for learning. So, what about our space? Well, we know we don't have this anymore. I love Mad Men. What I know about the 60s corporate space is from Mad Men, and I can't wait for the second half of season 7. But we don't have these corridors of hallway of offices where a single person can sit there in this lavish abode behind a mahogany desk on a leather chair with his weapon of choice. They did know how to party. I do wish we had more of that here. But now we have the paradigm shift has been largely the idea of the open studio. You're sitting in it right now. A place, an open space with many desks, many people talking, many people shouting across the room. There's very little audible and visual privacy in this scenario. So how do we actually work? We actually have to find a place in the office to actually get together and work. Because actually having a meeting at your desk, it's tough. It's really tough. Especially when you have music blaring overhead, there's a conversation going over somewhere else, there's someone in the kitchen talking about the dishwasher not being cleared out. It's hard to have a meeting at your desk. So we need meeting spaces. And we are not any kind of newbie to meeting spaces. We are very... It is Throwback Thursday. This is the space, of course. But we have many meeting spaces in this office. Some of them more flexible than others. Some of them rather rigid and formal. A lot of them are just impromptu, large spaces where we can spread out drawings and really speak across the table and get ideas out as best we can. What you don't see in these pictures, what don't you see? These are older pictures. These are no technology. Yes. I wish we still saw that. I want that back. But technology is pretty much void in these pictures. These are maybe 10 years old. So in 10 years, we've gone to the point of this, where we are just talking over paper, to coming to a meeting where we're expected to have the TV working. We're expected to have connectivity from your laptop at some point. Maybe there's a teleconference from another associate architect that's going to be online and has to have their technology piped into our technology. So we are definitely technologically advanced as far as the way our meeting spaces go. But really, this technology is just tools. These are just tools that get our ideas out of our brains onto some device and into someone else's brain so that our ideas can be conveyed. The real magic is the meeting space itself. So when I started talking about starting this presentation, I was already starting to look at the ways that a workspace can be designed and what's the newest trends in designing of a workspace. One of the biggest trends right now is the open plan, but with a big change to it. And that change is to not have assigned desks. Right now, we are very used to having our desk space. We are home right here in our desk space. But this new theory has multiple names. There's nothing really magical in the naming yet. There's nothing formal. But I've heard it called open plan, activity-based work. Mobile workspace is probably one I'll use in the future on this presentation. I particularly like hot desking and bleasure. They're good words, hot desking. Basically, the idea is you don't live there. You live somewhere else, but it is the technology that we have in the office right now that allows this to happen. At this very moment, we have a phone system that's going to be online very soon that will allow you to use your cell phone as your office phone. That number that you have coming through on your cell phone will look to the person that's calling as if you were in the office, no matter where you are. Doesn't matter if you're here, doesn't matter if you're in Starbucks, doesn't matter if you're in California. It'll look like you're coming from here. So that's something that will have, that'll give the owner or whoever you're calling some kind of feeling of solidarity in the office that is calling them, saying that they are a solid place. They're not mobile, they're not all over the place, they're not hard to reach. They are always at this phone number. The other thing is the advent of many computers that we have. The laptops are constantly being used, constantly being checked out. It's hard to find one nowadays. But what's driving all of this? Well, here's a study that says our area per person is shrinking quickly. In the 1970s, we had close to 500 square foot per person. We're rapidly approaching 100 square foot per person. So in these two images here, as a demonstration in 1,000 square feet, where one might have in 2000, four people in that 1,000 square feet. Now we'll have seven people in 2020 in that 1,000 square feet. So our physical footprint is getting smaller. Our time is also getting ripped from us. As we have more and more meetings in the middle of the day, this is a diagram saying for these 26 people, this is the amount of time they spent and where. It's either in face-to-face collaboration, virtual collaboration, individual work at their desks, or in travel. And notice how little there is in the middle that says they're sitting at their desk. Just like you were saying, there's a lot of dead space during the day. So how can we better utilize that? Well, mixing those two statistics, we can get to the idea that we can really start to shrink the square foot that we need in an office. We can do more with less if we start to think about our workspace more dynamically. If we unbound ourselves from our desks and commit to only being a digital employee, meaning that we work through PDFs, we use our phones as our communication device, our laptop is our connection to the server, and our workspace, we can work anywhere. Gensler did a study, has been studying the advances of office design since 2005, and in 2008, they identified four modes of working for the workplace. Focus is the one that we're familiar with. These are our desks, the way we have them now. And this is for individual concentration of productivity. And that takes up 48% of our time, roughly. I think Gensler probably polled more of a design office scenario rather than the previous slides were from DEGW. I think they were probably more of the corporate side. But this would probably more the design side where we do a lot of focused desk work. For 32% of our time, we're in collaborative work mode, where we are working with someone else, we're exchanging ideas, and ideally the space that we're in will reflect the needs for that. Learning and social are taking up 6% of our time each, learning being the time that we take to learn a new skill or a task. And social, that's one of those things that it will probably be hard for our employer to invest in, but these are these social spaces that allow informal conversations to happen. A break room that has booths or a nice coffee station that has seating that you could sit there and maybe do a little bit of working or something of the sort. So what do these spaces look like? I'll show some examples of some of these projects that have already, some of these companies that have already switched over to a mobile workspace environment. These employees will come in the morning and pick their desk. They have their laptops that are able to plug into a monitor station, and they could work there all day, pack up their things at the end of the day, and the next morning they may be in another location. I know some of you are probably scared about this, but it's okay. But we have opportunities like this. If we have nice moments in the office that are more leisurely, you can have more relaxed interface with your work. Really, the flexibility gives you the opportunity to be able to work in the mode that you're comfortable with. If you like a space that's quiet, you can take your stuff to the space that's quiet. If you like to work in a place that's lively and active, pick up your laptop and go to a place that's lively and active. This woman here, every morning, she takes her plants and brings them to a desk space that she likes. So you can do a little bit of personalization, but really it should pretty much fit in the box so you can be as mobile as you can be. The collaborate spaces are multi-size spaces that can serve multiple scales of meetings, from the two-person phone conversation to the four-person team huddle to the entire staff office meeting. This particular project is one I've been keeping an eye on for a while as we think about our office renovations. It's a massive place, but I love it. But the scale of the room, the scales of the room should match the use of the room for the meeting that it's being used for. Here's another image of a larger meeting space. Education or learning can happen in any of these spaces, but an office could have a nice large learning space where we are back to that eyes forward idea. But still, the technology connectivity is there so that everyone can get the information at the same rate and equally. But a small corner that allows a small meeting can be just as useful. This is Idea Paint headquarters in Boston. And of course, all of their walls can be written on with dry erase markers. This is the social space for the GLG group in New York City. This is in the lower level of their office. So employees can come down and tap on their laptops. They're on the same network. She's probably on a SIP IP phone right now conversation. There's places back here. There's some booths to allow a two-person conversation that's less formal than trying to talk at your desk. So these opportunities are good for the employee and also good for the productivity of the employee. This particular woman has a booth in her main office area just to change up the environment that she has to work in. So that's what I want to present to you, is the idea that maybe there's a different way to look at the office space and how we can interface with each other more digitally than we do now, and really open up the box so that we can maybe work a little freely, more freely. Now stop there.
So I'll follow from you by asking, what box? So why do we think about the world that we're in as if we're in boxes that we have to get out of? So that's one of the things that we're looking at in Albemarle County Public Schools right now. Quick question for you. When I pulled out my phone and started typing with my thumbs, how many of you thought I was texting or checking email or doing whatever, right? So you're gonna tweet me. I was taking notes about what folks said. We make assumptions about what people are doing. Well, when I talk about people, my average people age is about 11. Okay, so just imagine that that we, I work in a district where really one of the big things that we work for is to push as many choices as close to the learner as possible. So think about that. When my average age in my district is 11, as many choices. So would I trust an 11-year-old to make choices about pulling out a phone or pulling out an iPod or going to a cart and grabbing a laptop or an iPad? Or absolutely, absolutely. We're very unique in my district, and the techie, geeky folks in here will appreciate the fact that when I hand a kid a division-issued laptop and I say, this is your laptop for the academic year, that kid is a local administrator on that machine. So we get calls from vendors saying, we want to sell you this expensive software to lock down your systems, and I laugh at them. And I say, no, I'd rather buy more systems to give more stuff to kids. So really, that's kind of where we're going from. Not standard, not typical at all in the way we're doing that. So I've got, this is actually, I sent Dina this yesterday. It's actually a website that I created. I gave up slide stacks a long time ago, and I started building websites that I could use for talking points. So this one, I first did it at the Virginia Society for Technology and Education Conference in 2011. And I've used it a couple of times since then, looking at what infrastructures support contemporary learning. So we may have a great space with great furniture, but if I have the same classroom rules I had 20 years ago, so what? So if I still am building the same learning activities for kids as I did 20 years ago, so what? What we're going to find is that great space that we've worked so hard to build with VMDO isn't changing what kids do and how kids do it. Mm-hmm. So we're pushing back on those. It's pushing back through professional development, through how we allow schools to purchase stuff and what schools are able to do in order to really leverage some of the opportunities that they have. When we think about contemporary learning, I think also about, you know, those whole that whole set of questions. You know, when you're designing, who are you designing for? Mm-hmm. Who am I designing a lesson plan for or a learning activity for? Am I doing it for the state so that the kids will get a good score on a test? Or am I doing it for the kids so that they'll be positioned for the next thing that's going to come their way? So we're really trying to shoot for creating situations where kids, be they the 5-year-old kindergartners or the 18-year-old seniors that are about to go off to other spaces, are they able to be collaborative? Can we create situations where kids can say, I really need to work with somebody else on this, it's going to make it better for me? And then when we push back on that kid saying, no, you just want to hang out with Dina, you guys are going to goof off, that they can say, no, Dina helps me think by blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. So how do we get kids to be able to articulate what helps them learn? Mm-hmm. So that's a piece that we're working on too. So when we talk about choice in schools by, you know, every classroom that we're, when we refurnish a classroom now, there are at least three kinds of seats available. Mm-hmm. What we want is we want kids to be able to say, I like sitting on the stool when I'm writing because I like standing at the high table when I'm doing math because. I like sitting on the floor when I'm reading because. And believe it or not, I've been able to interview 6-year-olds that have been able to tell me those things, that have been able to say, if I'm over by the window when I'm trying to do math, I get distracted. But that's where I like to read. But this is where I like to do math. That's pretty cool. In a perfect world, we won't be segmenting the day either by subject area. You guys don't think, oh, wait a second, we're talking words, I need to put on my English hat right now and go to English class, right? You do that, it's just part of what you do. You go in and out, you know when to edit something for grammar usage and mechanics and when to just say, hey, I understood what she was saying, leave the rest of it alone. How do we help kids develop those skills too? So we have to hit those communication skills. Our phones and our devices and everything, they simultaneously screw things up and fix things for us. And we still need to be able to keep that communication layer going and be able to work through that. So, you know, looking at infrastructure and thinking about you know, to what extent do I care where kids learn? Do I care? Well, we have this term in school, it's called in loco parentis, which means that for right now, while you're in my room, I'm kind of your parent. So I have some responsibility. But we also have a responsibility to help that kid figure out time and place and purpose. Mm-hmm. And so if, as a teacher, you say to your kids, yeah, you can go work outside in the hallway, and the kids go running out the back door to the playground, mm-hmm. you're not really liable for what they're doing out there. Mm-hmm. So how do we work with teachers so that we don't take this protectionist attitude? I mean, you know, your teachers, how many of you had a fourth grade teacher that didn't care where you were? I mean, it's not that they don't care now, it's that they're more trusting of the kids and they're more explicit in giving kids permission to go other places and do other things. So how do we kind of back off from that a little bit to think the easiest way when you think, you know, use, strength, and beauty, Vitruvius's words, right? So the use, if the use is to control what you guys are doing, I am going to want you in a nice little place where I can see all your eyes and tell that you're looking at me. If the use is to help you become a self-sufficient learner that can collaborate, communicate, think critically, and be creative to solve really big problems, then why would I think I need to control you? So what does the balance look like? So one of the phrases that Dina latched on, I think, early on in the Brownsville project mm-hmm. was the phrase of perceived privacy. I want my 8-year-olds, third graders, mm-hmm. typical third graders, to think they're in a room like grown-ups would be collaborating without a teacher. Mm-hmm. They don't notice that there's a glass wall and I can see them, right? They really don't. They don't notice there's a glass wall there. So we've created all kinds of spaces that give the perceived privacy mm-hmm. For kids and afforded them the opportunities to do some of the real world kind of work that you guys are doing. Mm-hmm. So these are some pictures from some of our real classrooms. So we got a middle school classroom here. This is a middle school language arts classroom in one of our schools that's a one-to-one school. And you walk into this classroom and you can see the teachers brought in camp chairs. Here's one of the old desks from the room with a director's kind of chair there. Kids are sitting all over the place in there, plugged in. They're getting their privacy the same way you are, through your earbuds, right? That's how you get privacy when you're working in a place like this. And what's on their computer screens? They're actually working. They're writing skits here that they're gonna perform. This kid right here says, I really like to read laying down, but, and he said, but it's hard for, it hurts my arms to hold my book up. So he scoured the room, got a milk crate, and rigged it up to be his little book holder. So this is Idea Paint. You saw the Idea Paint offices here on a little nook in a library. That used to be that little nook area used to be a traditional computer lab with rows and tables of fixed technology. Mm-hmm. So we're unfixing our technology. Our kids are mobile. Mm-hmm. So that idea of a teaching wall that everybody's eyes go to is we're really backing off of that. Mm-hmm. We do have projectors in every learning space. We talk about learning spaces, not classrooms, because we really do want every space in a school to be seen as a learning space. So even making that little shift in language is a big deal for mm-hmm. folks. This is one of our high school libraries down here with the couch. And yeah, you've got walk into rooms. This is I think that's a second grade room there. And you got kids sitting all over the place. This is not from one of our schools, but it's some furniture that we were looking at. We put a booth in your cafeteria. What this does show is smaller monitors versus the teacher presentation place. So collaboration spaces for kids. So we've got Walton Middle School, if any of you have been in there. There's an amphitheater, really nice amphitheater in the center of the school, close proximity to the library. And what we did there is put multiple collaboration monitors around at sit-on-the-floor height. So it's great when you walk into the room and you see clusters of four or five kids, one of them has their laptop plugged in, and they're collaborating there. So they may have a Google Doc up where they're all simultaneously editing the same document. One person's kind of showing what's going on, and or maybe a person's doing research that the group's looking at, and other people are adding their notes to the shared collaborative document. So yeah, you can keep scrolling down. So this site, Dina's got the URL. It's got a lot of stuff that we're doing. It's got links to some of the old professional development. It's about 2 years old. But really looking at, in a perfect world, our eight-year-olds would be able to say, I need this tool to do this work that I care about. Mm-hmm. So, hey, teacher, help me. And we'd be able to go from that. So we did an internal grant project back in 2013. We called it Design 2015. Sure. Let's design what we're going to be doing in 2015. Mm-hmm. So every school submitted a proposal for an idea, and we funded 26 ideas. Actually, we funded 27 ideas. We've got 26 schools. But looking at the idea of making a lot of small mistakes, and making a lot of small successes, and then figuring out from there what should be scaled across, if anything. So we've made some decisions about furniture, we've made some decisions about technology through that. So yeah, we know that if what a group of kids wants to do is use tablets to access books, we know that there's cheaper ways of doing that than Kindles. And they actually, you know, we figured all of those kinds of things out. So, so this site is available to you guys. Can you go back to the main site, the first one, first tab? Yeah. But with all of that, can you click on the Move Beyond Allowing link? With all of that, we do have to kind of move beyond allowing. So mm-hmm. kids are constantly in the position of asking permission. Mm-hmm. Can I go to the bathroom? Can I, you know, do this? Can I do that? How do we get rid of that and create an atmosphere like this? I mean, how many, do you guys have to raise your hand to go to the bathroom when you need to? I don't think so. Oh, you do? You know, I don't think so. But I think, you know, how do we create these structures in our classrooms where, yeah, I need to know where the 18 eight-year-olds in my charge are at all times. But I don't have to be monitoring everything that they're doing at all times. And we have to have created a community, and we have to be able to deal with it when people go outside of that community that we created. And they have to know what their expectations are. And we have to engage parents in this. Every time we've got every kid in Albemarle County Public Schools has a Google account, and we've got a couple of parents that have said, I really don't want that. Okay. We've got kids that are using WordPress to do blogs. We host our own WordPress server for kids to blog on, and we do all sorts of things so that kids can start using the tools that real people use to do real stuff. So it's pretty amazing when you have a group of kids that are really looking at trying to change the world through some of the service learning that they're doing, and we're saying, that's great. Would you like to post that project on a WordPress site mm-hmm. that we're hosting? And by the way, the kids are also the administrators of the WordPress sites. So that's pretty cool too. And finally, the third tab there. I've got a little blog that I do called The Calculus of the Classroom. Any of you that took calculus will, and anybody spent time in school, in schools these days, you know two words that we use in school a lot are differentiation and integration. Mm-hmm. I first encountered those in calculus. Mm-hmm. And so I thought, you know, when I encountered those in education, I thought, all right, these two words, they're coming together kind of in both places. How is it that they relate? So I landed on the fact that differentiation is chopping things up in the smallest pieces possible so that we can understand them. And educators in the room, that's really aligned with what the literature says about differentiation. And then integration is putting things that I can understand together in ways that approximate reality. So how do I integrate the curriculum so that I don't have kids saying, oh, it's 10:30, it must be math time. That we're able to dig in and do deep project work that kids lose track of time. They're not bound by that box of the bell or the teacher saying, time to put your writing away, it's time to switch to numbers now. So one of the things this is my most recent blog, there's in the IT world, there is this principle of least privilege. So the general rule in information technology is that I'm going to be in control and I'm going to give you as little stuff as possible so that you stand a chance at being able to do your job. Right? If I don't want you to be able to screw up your printer, then I'm going to like assign you a printer and that's the only place you can ever print to. Is that the way you run this office? Uh-oh. So what we've done is blown that out of the water. No, I'm going to give you the keys to the car with some driver's ed training also. So we do that. So we rely heavily on digital citizenship work. And I mean, you may have people that are coming to this office and they're here for 7-8 hours a day and don't accomplish a whole lot. I mean, grown-ups do that too. But eventually, somebody catches on to that. So how do we help kids become self-moderators? It is so easy to get distracted and in your phones. This is just the Notes app. So easy to get distracted and sucked into your phone. How do you keep yourself from doing that? I would just as soon work with 8 to 12-year-olds to develop that as you guys get them here as 24-year-olds or you get them there as an 18-year-old. They have no clue. Why do so many kids drop out of college after their first year? Because they can't do that. They can't say, I have an exam, I need to go to bed early tomorrow night. Tonight's my party night. They don't do that well. People that go to college and are 4 and out or 3 and out do those kinds of things really well. So how do we get over some of that? So yeah, Facebook's open at our high schools. We haven't opened it at our middle schools and our elementary schools, frankly, because the kids aren't old enough. Age 13 is based on a federal guideline. So, but when they get to high school, yep, they have that distraction. When teachers complain to me about it, I said, hey, would you like some help planning learning activities that will compete with Facebook? Because I can help you with that. I can help you compete with Facebook, but I won't block stuff because you're not changing what you're doing. So we've got a lot of this that we have going on in our schools, a lot of interesting spaces where kids can goof off and screw around and all of that and sit on seats that don't work with them. And okay, so how do you make a better choice next time? So we're working with kids on making better choices. We're unfixing a lot of the technology that we spent the last 10 years fixing around rooms. So we're going to more mobile technologies and less permanent fixture kinds of technologies in our schools. And looking at the fact that kids, if you put an iPad or an iPod, an iPad, and a computer in front of an 8-year-old and ask them which one they'd rather work with, guess what they're going to tell you? They'd rather work with this because they can put it in their pocket and go. They want to have access to the other ones, but this is what they want to have with them all the time. So how do we respond to that? It's not going to be by creating better teaching spaces. It's going to be by creating better learning spaces and by creating better places and opportunities for kids to engage. So that's kind of what we're going after. I don't know, argue with me, Laura. You have any arguments about this? Laura's a teacher in one of our schools. So we'll segue into this because she's working with you're fourth grade now, so you're working with the 9 and 10-year-olds that I've given free rein to. So we'll see how this works out, right? They've got Google accounts. They've got all kinds of stuff. Blackboard accounts.
We are using Google Calendar instead of a traditional agenda book for them to record their homework assignments and their due dates. And we love our Google.
Right. So I'm going to give the classroom teacher perspective, and it's going to be quite practical what my day-to-day life looks like, what some of these concepts kind of look like in the classroom. And when I first thought about what does technology look like for me and from a classroom teacher's perspective, this is kind of the opposite of it, like standing in front of you with a PowerPoint presentation and talking at you. That's very rarely what my day looks like. Never with a PowerPoint am I standing in front of a room full of students talking at them. So when I think about structuring my classroom, I think about two things. Project-based learning. This is a special student for Karen Marcus and me. A project.
Just so you know.
I don't think we can say names.
She is.
This was the only graphic I had where I happen to have my bullseye from the classroom of the ways we work kind of anchor chart. And so I think about this throughout the day. How do my varying students' experiences throughout those different types of work, and how am I framing project-based learning as kind of the guiding structure for everything? I think project-based learning is a really easily misunderstood phrase because we've all done projects, we've all maybe made a diorama in school, and there can be the misunderstanding that like, oh yeah, we did that, we made posters. And project-based learning is different than that because it's work that's around a driving question, it's interdisciplinary, it's authentic work where students are solving real life problems. One other thought on how I use technology. I can't quite separate how I use technology from my day-to-day instruction because I don't begin with technology. I don't begin by saying, I'm going to use this tool, what will I do with it? I begin by thinking, what do I want students to do? And then finding the best tool for that job. And sometimes it's an analog tool, and sometimes it's a digital tool. So here's an example of two students working independently, writing, one student writing paper and pencil, who wants to do some sketching work, and another student who wants to write digitally. Neither has greater value. It's about, as Becky was saying, it's about student choice. Students working collaboratively in pairs. Again, as Becky was talking about, choice in where they work and how they work. A current struggle in my new classroom is I'm teaching in a tiled classroom for the first time. So not having a carpet is really challenging for me.
Yeah,
but
you can write on the floor.
Becky, we differ in that a little bit though. But so these guys have some rugs. And these students are collaborating in a project on a tool called FieldScope. And this was part of our first project-based learning unit of this current school year on watersheds in Virginia, and we used the driving question, how do watersheds work and how can I help watersheds in our community? And so in an early learning activity in that, when we were becoming experts on what a watershed is in our area watershed, students looked at did a map study with all different types of maps. So we had some huge Albemarle County maps, some fold-out paper maps of Virginia, some watershed maps of the whole United States. And just for good measure, to have some technology in there, I had them use Google Earth as well. And it was the wrong tool for the job, and it became a distraction from the learning because students, the satellite imaging was so exciting. They were really excited to find tennis courts and to try to find their neighbor's house and to look for dogs, that no one found any watersheds and no one knew any names of watersheds or could track any watersheds. And it became a distraction from what was otherwise really engaging, the map work that was happening at the other stations. And in contrast then, later in the unit, when we used this tool, FieldScope, which is an example of a citizen science program where students are recording their area watershed, they're working with topographical maps and elevation, and they're doing calculations with flow. It was the right tool for the job. And in fact, it was the perfect tool because it's something that couldn't have happened without technology. There's no paper map that can replicate that kind of learning activity, and especially the citizen science part where they're contributing that data to a network of comparing it to other students' data around the country and around the world and looking at how does our Chesapeake Bay watershed different than the Great Lakes watershed and elsewhere around the world. So that's contributing to a bank of citizen science data. And when technology is that way, where it's the perfect tool for the job and not just inserted for novelty, that's what gets me excited about technology in classrooms. So we also work whole group for a lot of it. We spend a lot of our time gathered in a circle, having group discussions. And sometimes there is that everybody look at one screen, but it's usually not because I'm talking. So in this situation, we're Skyping with some scientists about beginning of the year science projects. They've planned a science project that they're going to research and develop on their own, and they're consulting with experts on their ideas and getting feedback on their first drafts. So when I think about what connectivity means, I think that this is a big part of it. How do we connect students with experts in the different fields, with an audience for their work, with the information that they can then use critical thinking skills to tease through? Whereas in the past, it was about getting them information. Trust this knowledge, here I'll give you the knowledge. But now students need practice finding their own knowledge and information and then teasing out what's worthwhile and what's not reputable. I want to talk about an example of one interdisciplinary project-based learning unit that we did, and it was to build a garden fence. And so it had started as a garden project that I do every year where we work in the garden and we have the driving question of how can we use our garden to contribute to the community. And so in this year's garden work, we had been invaded by a groundhog, and a groundhog was eating our produce all season long. And so the students were the drivers, and they said, we need a fence. We need some kind of fence. So it became a multi-month project of researching different types of fences. There was a lot of math work in measuring. There was a lot of math in pricing. There was a lot of language arts in writing letters to people to get quotes and soliciting help. There was math again in the scheduling of the fence building day. And then after the fence was built, we decided to have a fence commemoration ceremony where we shared the history of Murray, students shared a special song they had written, they shared the maps they had made of the garden, and they hosted garden tours. And so, again, authentic, real work, they needed to make invitations to invite all the people who had helped us build our fence, and students had choice in how to do that. And some students chose to create beautiful watercolor invitations like these, and some students chose to create beautiful digital invitations like these. And it's not that either is of greater value than the other. We don't value the watercolor more than the digital product, but we value the choice that students have the right to decide what tool they want to use to best represent their work. Some of the research that guides my thinking about setting students up for these learning opportunities are Marzano's effective instructional strategies and Schlechte's engaging qualities. And these are huge for us in Albemarle County. I know you're likely all already familiar with Bloom's taxonomy, and so that is also, of course, a driver. Marzano's research is about which instructional activities are most effective, yield the highest results. And he found that these nine have the highest results. So project-based learning is a great format for my instruction, I think, because so many of these are woven in. There's going to be so many of these just by necessity woven into how the unit flows. And likewise, Schlechte's engaging qualities, so when we are evaluating a classroom or when I'm evaluating my own work and asking, are students engaged? Is this higher level thinking? Is this effective instruction? It's not subjective. These are measures that we can use to help see, yes, students are engaged, and I know that because there are three engaging qualities present in my work. And these engaging qualities, it would be almost impossible to teach with a true project-based learning approach and not have more than three of those running at any one time. And a common thread between both of these that connects to the next line of research that I want to talk about is this recognizing effort and providing recognition for students and sense of audience. Those two things are both woven well into project-based learning, and they tie tightly to some research out of Harvard's Project Zero on how to make thinking visible. And that's something I think a lot about. How do I help students' thinking and learning process be visible? The cloud is a really great space to be able to store all of our things and pull them down from anywhere. but it's not a great space for students to be able to have a trail of where they learned and to reflect on their own learning and solidify that learning. So how do we help them do that? How do we pull it down from the cloud and make it a little more concrete? The Project Zero work talks about how that work, making thinking visible, has value both in the reflection stage at the end of a unit. How do we look back on the unit and see where we went, where did we begin our learning, how did my learning develop, how did I learn best along the way, and then solidify those understandings. But also it helps during the process to have some documentation of the learning as it's happening. So here's kind of three examples from my classroom of my attempts to do that, to document the learning while it's in process and then in reflection. So a class blog where students are taking turns authoring for the week and reflecting and summarizing the week's learning. So especially when there's big classroom events or at the culmination of things, looking back and documenting, here's how this unit started and here's how it developed and then here's where we ended. So this was a project-based learning unit with the same driving question as the fence unit, how can we help the community with our garden? But a different outcome where students had decided to donate our produce and some Thanksgiving gift cards and gift bags to the Meals on Wheels recipients. And project-based learning is also a nice way to tie in that service learning component. This is our window out to the garden, and that's our beautiful fence. And this is a table of students' plant growth. In the fall, we do a collaborative garden, and in the spring, I traditionally had done, when I taught second grade, students had individual plots. But I still wanted that to be a collaborative experience, even though they had their own plot to make choices on. So they each had their own row in the table where they could document the dates and their observations and their plant heights, and then also be able to see it and compare it to other students to see who's growing similar things to me, how are mine growing in comparison to others, and develop some of that scientific thinking. And then this is from the same watershed project that I had mentioned earlier. At the end of the unit, I printed all of the pictures that I had taken throughout the unit, that we had taken, that students had taken on iPods, and that I had taken on my phone, and printed them all out. And we put them out in a big cluttered jumble and had students work collaboratively to make sense of them and sequence them and talk about the learning that had happened at each phase. So they decided in their summaries then that there were six phases to our learning. They chose images that they thought best represented each of those phases. Then they broke out into small groups and worked to write a summary of what they had done and what they had learned from it, and then to sequence them into a hall display that could show that process to others. So one other idea that Harvard Project Zero links to is the idea of Reggio Emilia's atelier of a, you all are really familiar with this, that's awesome. A space where that work is made visible. And we don't have that space necessarily. You know, we have some traditional display cases in my school, but thinking about where do students get to share their work and present their work meaningfully, sometimes digitally, and sometimes there's value in having it be concrete also. And that's it.
I'm curious, did somebody teach you about the value of the physical environment and how to use that as an affordance for what you do? So, yeah, how do you think of ways to use what you have versus, you know, working with the designer to design what you want?
Our school has not been renovated since the 40s, and I am now in a new wing of the school in my new role in fourth grade, and my current room is half the size of my old room, and it's it has some structural things. The paint is peeling, the wood is peeling. There are some, I have no carpet. There are things like, I don't mean to bad mouth Albemarle County. I love my classroom and I love my school. But there are some challenges in that space. And it may be cliche in your field to say flexible spaces, but I think it with the current size of my classroom, thinking of the space flexibly is really important.
Yeah, 1991, I think, was the last year that the school had. It opened in 91 with some renovations.
And the current wing that I'm in is the original wing. It was originally the black school for Albemarle County, and it was the segregated school.
One of them. One of them served that area.
So
I actually, that was my first school that I taught in was that school. Yeah, it's one of those buildings that got closed down from being an elementary school when Meriwether Lewis was, the new Meriwether Lewis was built. The kids that went to Murray Elementary were districted there, and Murray Elementary closed down and reopened as Murray High School in 1988, the first year that alternative program existed. So we just had that old wing then they opened Meriwether Lewis, the brand new building, with trailers because they had miscalculated the population. Mm-hmm. So we were there for 2 years and then moved into the old Rose Hill Elementary building after that while they renovated, added the primary wing. So yeah, that's a school. Primary wing's got some metal walls between some of the classrooms, so you can open those up and make larger spaces. I don't know if you knew that.
We've explored that option. I used to share a wall with my best friend who was in the classroom next door, and we wanted to open the wall between our classrooms, and we were told it wasn't an option, but it was hard.
Who told you that? I'll bring my tools.
Andy Ryder told me that.
So, one of the things that I do as a central office person is I debunk myths like that. around. No, you can do that.
So, thinking, you know, the whole group gathering space is a non-negotiable for me. We meet every morning in a morning meeting. We close every day in a closing circle. I need that whole group space. So Jim helped me set up my classroom a little bit at the beginning of the year, and that meant some. The tables are bunched together. The tables are really close together because I felt like it was really important to have a lot of open spaces so that students could have choice in whether they wanted to work at a table or wanted to work on the floor and could break out. And in a classroom of that size, every corner is used. Mm-hmm. So I have a desk space, but I have a small desk that's kind of catty corner. And when students break out in partnerships, there's always a partnership that goes under or behind my desk. Like, I couldn't have the teacher nook where nobody goes back here. I would love it, but the square footage doesn't allow for it. So students break out into every square corner, and we talk about how to make sure you have at least 2 yards between you and another partnership so you're able to focus and not distract others. And when we break out with 2 yards apart, that uses every corner of the room.
So I think we're, as architects, and especially in educational spaces, tasked with designing flexible spaces a lot. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I think you can almost not design something with the intention of it being flexible. So you're sort of, it's not that you're punting on the solution, because you don't want to over prescribe a space that could be used in another way. And I think wireless technology is obviously freeing that up a lot, that we don't have to say, this is a teaching wall, this could be a teaching wall, etc. But I didn't know from people that have just done some planning and are also thinking, you know, are there sort of rules of thumb when you think about flexible spaces, and especially with technology, you know, easy do's and don'ts for certain types of spaces.
Karen, you had something to say?
Yeah, answer this question. Make the room big enough. For some reason, up until the last 10 years, we've made room, as the kids got bigger, we made the rooms small, which makes absolutely no sense. So you put plenty of plugs like on your tables at Sweetbriar, plenty of places, and make the school wireless, but make the room big enough, for gosh sakes. 1,000 square feet minimum for any classroom. And I know that's bigger than state specs unless they've changed. Or are they 25?
Well, when you look at what's, I mean, we're not taking kids to a computer lab anymore. You know, we have the computer lab right there in the room.
Right.
So there's a lot of stuff that's in there. We haven't lost much of our print material. You still have board games in your rooms. You know, you still have a lot of that legacy stuff too, because that's good stuff for kids to be interacting with. We don't want to take away that experience of playing Monopoly on a board game and just, you know, do the iPad version all the time. although it's easier to cheat on the iPad version. But you know, so how do you, you know, how do we accommodate all of that? And you know, the second you take out any of the storage, people say they need more storage. The second you put all of the storage that a teacher would ever want, there's no space to write on the wall. You've got no wall space.
Unless you put it, you know, why so.
So the question about, right, storage for whom and storage for what and how easily accessible does it have to be? So, you know, how do you do that combination? They've taken the coat rack out of the classroom and put it out in the hallway. And, you know, what's that?
We did that.
Yep. to get, you know, I mean, you wouldn't believe how much space, you know, 20 coats and 20 backpacks takes up. But we have to now... You know, we felt a little more protected when it was in the room. Our stuff was a little safer there. So how do we make sure it's safe out in the hallway? And, you know, we've got all kinds of things that are happening there. And, you know, when we talk about charging, you know, we're putting USB outlets around also because it's one less thing that a kid has to deal with to charge something. So how do we create... You know, these multi-platform charging stations also that and we've had issues where folks, you know, there is a desire, especially with many of our buildings get used by the public after school, so you don't want to lease out rent out a school's library and have all of this mobile technology sitting out unprotected. So we need to lock things up and store them and charge them, which generates heat, so now we need to be ventilated, you know, so what there are a lot of things to consider there. So how do we make things simultaneously easy to get to but not in the way when we're not using them? That idea of putting, being able to hide it when you don't want it is critical, and being able to create spaces. You know, I saw in one of your pictures, you had what we call huddle boards.
Yeah.
The little you know, those are great, but it's still not the same as a huge idea paint wall.
Yeah. The old, what we wanted to do idea paint, and then we ran into the older masonry walls.
Yes.
So that was
a compromise. So you have to do a lot of wall work there. So right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And see, for me, one of the things, the way I kind of think about it is. I mean, what's changing now is that it's not that suddenly there's technology in the classroom, it's just more the acceleration of it. I mean, I was going back and thinking, okay, we're dealing with a room here that was kind of early on, they were designed early on electricity, right? Or even some of the rooms that were designed sort of pre-electricity, so when you're having to light the room, so the light of the room, the space, the scale, the scope of the room, and then how people are going to be using it, it's still got to be a place where people are going to want to be in, right? In that sense, if we think of the chief weakness of this type of stuff is, you know, the eye strain, right? And the bags they have to haul around with laptops and stuff like that. They need to find space that they can sit in and be in that's comfortable, and that's not, you know, so the some of the older design elements, the larger rooms, the little higher ceilings, the more that pay attention to the setting of the building in relation to the seasons and the sun. Can, when you start seeing what some of the older architects were doing, and capturing that, and then finding ways to do that in a modern style, you can get something really cool.
I have a couple words that keep popping up in my head based on all that you've shared. One was control, this idea of management, sequencing. So these are all processes and they're pretty high-level things, and I'm wondering, and then I kind of flickered to a bunch of schools that I toured in Copenhagen, where the spatial organization and the content management is decentralized. So access to, whether it's analog or digital tools or whatnot, is freed up from specific areas. Like libraries have all kinds of small outposts and outcroppings all over the school, and there seems to be maybe a different paradigm about management control and this kind of allowance or allowing that is also reflected in the architecture. And it sounds like we have so much old infrastructure that's so hard to tweak.
But I'm wondering if you could, in your dream scenario, as you move forward with this concept of allowance, differentiation and integration, would you go to?
Yeah, give you an example. High school kids no longer use lockers. Middle school kids can't wait to get their lockers. So one of the things, if you go to Monticello High School, which is one of our newer constructions, the lockers have been largely removed. And the areas where the lockers were are now open informal spaces, and we're putting comfortable seating out there. So it's no longer that the library is the only place to go and chill out, because you can be supervised by the librarian there. You know, there are classrooms all around these little common areas. If somebody's goofing off out there, somebody's going to hear them. And, you know, if somebody's in danger, somebody's going to hear them. So that's, you know, we want to trust the kids that if we create a great space for them to work, they'll actually go to that space and work. And we're seeing that largely. And, I mean, if you look at what colleges and universities are doing, you go to Rice Hall, you mentioned that earlier. There's some really cool collaboration spaces set up there. Why can't we do that, especially at our high schools? Because if our kids can't make that transition, if they can't find that quiet study space when they need a quiet study space, or they can't find that, you know, four-kid group collaboration space when they need it, how are they going to be able to navigate that next thing that's coming their way? So, you know, that's one of the things that we're working for. So we're finding those spaces. Yeah. It wasn't designed that way. When we built Monticello High School, you know, 15 years ago, we didn't say, one of these days, high school kids won't use lockers anymore, so we'll be able to take them out and have these, you know, that wasn't, that's just, you know, somebody said, well, the kids aren't using the lockers anyway, what if? So they've now made it, you can request a locker, and they've got about 100 kids that request a locker.
And the market and the imperative for colleges and universities, particularly private ones, that emerges from that is this. And just watching what you guys are doing here is just so fabulous. And as what I've been telling my colleagues and, you know, people at other schools, you know, there's no luxury to wait, right? If you want to be, you want to be competitive as a college, you want the best students, you have to be doing this, right? Because they're doing it, right? This is all they've ever known. So they come to college and you're doing it like, you know, it was in the 80s, just because that's what you're comfortable, because that's when you were in grad school. You're not going to get the students you want, you're just not going to be able to keep them, right? So there's a huge imperative there for colleges and universities to pay attention to what's going on in K through 12 in this, because this is where some of the best stuff is being done.
Middle school kids, by the way, when we did, we're handing out our brand new laptop computers on the first day of school, my tech folks were helping kids, more kids with their lockers than they were with their computers. It was hilarious. So the kid, hand them a Windows 8 machine, tell them, you know your username and password, they're logging in, yep, I can log in, great, shut down, now can you help me open my locker? It was hilarious.
So that kind of, for me, brings up, it's kind of a question I wanted to ask. It seems like you've kind of fostered this great sense of, and you use the phrase digital citizenship, and is that coming about because you have these people giving classes, or is it just innate, or what's your sort of feeling on the culture of, I guess, kids and being responsible with computers? Because for me, I imagine, you know, middle school, high school, people are kind of, you know, graffitiing lockers and, you know, like, sort of vandalizing and destroying space. And I went to a really large, really large Northern Virginia school, so that's to be expected. But, you know, we couldn't be trusted with a class set of laptops, definitely couldn't be trusted with individual laptops, although, you know, that's a whatever. But does this kind of happen innately, or?
Yeah, and we have our school, we're very fortunate that our school board, our school board chair, actually our former chair, talks about punishing the behavior and not the technology. So kids absolutely found all kinds of ways, like graffitiing lockers, right? So are we going to ban all pens and pencils and paint from the school because somebody wrote something on a bathroom wall? No. You know, we're gonna try to figure out who did it, try to keep it from happening again, clean it up, and move on. So we really do the same sort of thing with technology. And you know, if you we've got a couple of kids this year. I'll just give one example. I could give a couple of examples, but we had four or five kids that really planned not as sophisticated as it could have been, but it was pretty sophisticated denial of service attack on our own network. And they're like using our computers. And it's like, you guys are making it pretty easy to find out who you are. And the kids did get suspended from school because they had denied service. So we have every parent signs off on a responsible use agreement. We expect all teachers to address the terms of that agreement when they're, you know, when Laura hands out the paperwork to her kids, she has a spiel that she goes through. When she rolls out a new tool like Google Earth or Google Apps for Education, she's ultimately responsible for that frontline education. Now, we've provided her with a lot of materials. We've provided her with workshops so that she knows how to do it. She's got some phone-a-friend support from my team. And we really try to partner with the parents so that they know, you know, I want to change the conversation the kids have with the parents. Because parents are concerned about screen time. You know, my kid spends a lot of time on the screen, and now you're going to give them a computer and tell them that their homework's going to be on the computer too? Oh my God, I'll never see my child again. So one of the things that we did as part of each of our one-to-one rollouts this year is we had a parent meeting, you know, where we came and the principals or somebody else at the school talked about why we're doing this from a value added for learning standpoint, and then we opened it up to questions, and we got questions everything from keyboarding to, you know, will my kid be able to, will other people in the family be able to use the computer you're sending home? This is really cool. We've never had a computer before. So just the whole gamut there.
And as you can probably tell from what Becky's saying, it definitely does not just happen innately. It happens very intentionally.
Very, very intentionally.
Very slowly and very deliberately.
And we really do believe kids will make mistakes. School's one of the safest places in the world for a kid to make a mistake.
I sort of asked if it was innately, just because I would be shocked, just because
totally.
You know, the way my high school and middle school was is, you know, if there was one person left in the computer lab at some point, all the screensavers would be changed, all the desktops would be changed, all the mice would disappear, and you know, like.
Oh, we've got a middle school where the big thing is popping keys off of the keyboard.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
So, you know, when the principal does a school-wide meeting and shows the bill that he got from my department for repairing keys and says, you guys know who's doing this, cut it out. Because we can't go, you know, if I have to spend instructional money on replacing keys on the keyboard, we're not going to be able to go on that school-wide field trip at the end of the year. And what I would really like to see is the kids doing that self-policing. And I got a call from a high school assistant principal a couple of years ago, and he said, we've got a Twitter problem. We're like, what's wrong? Is Twitter down or something? And no, the kids they had a really attractive student teacher. And some kids posted on Twitter some things about this student teacher who had apparently crossed a couple of lines anyway, but and it was overtaking, you know, this Twitter chatter was overtaking the school at that point. So we sat down, we went through, and I said, all right, let's look at some of these tweets, because they were all using the school's hashtag, which was hilarious. Right, they're like they're just so naive, they think we're stupid, you know. So we plucked out a couple of kids. I said, tell me the kids that are leaders. I don't care. I don't want the kids that are in the leadership class. I want the kids that are the real leaders in the school. He picked out six or eight kids. We called them in one by one and had that conversation. I said, you know what? I said, we're about to roll out one-to-one at ninth grade at this school, and that's great. This is how much money the school division's putting in it. This is how much money a system to stop you guys from using Twitter on your cell phones would cost me. Where do you want me to spend the money? And the kids were like, so stop it. Well, I didn't do it. I said, I know, but you know who did. Stop it. And really pushing it back so that the kids are controlling. They're the ones looking at other kids. That 8-year-old saying to a kid, that's not right, stop it, is far more powerful than any of us looking at the kid saying stop it. So we really try to build that out. It's all, you know, and it's not just about computer stuff. It's about bullying, it's about, you know, litter, it's about wasting water, it's about all of those things. We really want to build that community of respect and respect for everything, our community resources, each other, and the work that we're here to do together.
And when Becky said earlier, if we use the same rules that we had 20 years ago, they won't work. And I thought, that's something I disagree with, because I have the same roles that I've always had, and they work for technology. And they, you know, if we have a classroom rule that we're going to respect our materials, that includes the computer. So if you're going to carry the laptop by the top of it, then you'll lose your laptop privilege. Just as if you were snapping pencils, we would come up with a logical, natural consequence for that. So the rules are the same. We just have to figure out how they apply a little bit differently as the technology changes.
Does the county provide all the teaching of different technologies and how to integrate that in school learning, or do you find these different programs yourself and try to integrate them?
Can I answer that?
The county has some programs that they have platforms for, and then there are, if we want to use other programs that require student account, then there's a protocol to follow for deciding if it's safe for student use and whether we can or cannot use it.
And in terms of professional development, yeah, we do. In fact, Laura does some of our professional development for us. She does project-based learning and digital tools at the elementary school. So teachers, you did some workshops for us this summer. So we did 12 days in July where folks could actually come, 24 opportunities to come to a half-day workshop all around digital tools that we provide. And we even let teachers trade off contract days if they participated in those, so which was great. So we got great participation in that. It's not an option. You know, do we have teachers that aren't where Laura is in terms of her flexibility? The fact that she can choose a tool, have it not work, and then tomorrow choose a different tool, that's really cool. That's what I'd like to see in teachers. And we've got folks that are telling me, now I'm waiting for the county to figure this all out and tell me what I have to do. Well, you'll be waiting a long time because we expect you to be the professional making those decisions, the day-to-day decisions based on what your kids need. So we've got the gamut
nice
there.
Internal structures, right? For like, if we're thinking instruction first, if we're thinking learning outcomes first, here's what I want students to do. If teachers can be very clear about what they want students to know, understand, and be able to do, then there are people within the school and within
right.
the county who can help them. So I'm like have a technology title within my school. I forget exactly what it is, but so if people have a question like that, they can say, Laura, this is what I want to do. Do you know a tool that can help me match that learning outcome?
I feel like, you know, we work really hard to put these different technologies or flexible furniture and spaces, and you know, you come back 2 years later and you find sometimes the teachers don't know how to use those different things.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, just trying to understand how the protocol works after that for the teachers and principals and school systems to continue to know how to use all the technology and flexible spaces and what the building has to offer.
Yeah, we've got, I just got an email from a librarian. We put a new glass board in a library, and she wants somebody to come show her how to use it, which is like, that just floors me. It's like, okay, I'll come with the dry erase marker and write on it and say, here, and look, not only can I put it on there, I can take it off. You know, so it's really kind of funny. But yeah, folks are at different stages of being open to this. You know, we've made some mistakes by putting stuff in spaces without consulting the people that occupy those spaces, and that's not very smart. We have to engage them. And that herding cats idea, you know, if we could push so far, but we don't want to break the rubber band, nor do we want to say, you're okay here. You know, we want to pull out in service of the kids.
And
so,
I think sometimes the technology or the space can be on the front end. Like in the case of Brownsville, there was a beautiful, open, flexible space. And at first, when teachers first occupied that space, they weren't sure what to do with it. And they were a little confused and a little overwhelmed. And now, in the last 2 to 3 years, we've seen the makerspace.
I am texting now, getting texts from my family wondering where I am.
We've seen makerspace kind of take off, and every school wants a makerspace and a maker workshop. And they had that 5 years ago or whenever Brownsville was completed, but they were a little confused by it. So it's okay that the design was a little bit ahead, I think, of what was happening. They weren't quite ready for it when they first occupied that space, but then when makerspace came, when people became more aware of it, it started spreading more widely, they realized, we have a makerspace, we're going to recreate this as a makerspace.
And we've got schools, you know, the maker is a great continuum to look at, because we've got schools that say, why do we need a space? We make in our classrooms all day long. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I liken that to that transition from a computer lab to, like, distributed computing. So we thought at some point it was more convenient, more efficient to send kids to a special room where all the technology sat. And now we've reversed that and we're sending the technology to the rooms. So will the same thing happen with making?
I also think that's about, like, somewhere there's a disconnect in the conversation between the person who designed the space, the reasons for it. Like, there are often times when, as a user of a space, I don't know why something is the way that it is. So my sister's a scientist, and her lab was renovated, and everyone was criticizing all of these different features of the renovation, and Jim walked the building with her wanting to see the school new building, and she was like, well, why is the bathroom way over here? And, you know, and Jim could see pretty quickly why some things were the way that they were, and as soon as my sister understood them, she was really excited by it and thought, wow, that's, I love that, and that's neat. And so how to have that conversation, how to actually, once the building is built and teachers are actually occupying the space, how to connect the person who designed it to the users of the space to say, here's what I had in mind for this space.
I think, too, a lot of times the divisions where you guys are coming in and doing mm-hmm. these great projects, a lot of times the school division, the people that are in these middle positions mm-hmm. between teachers and the architects don't know how to help teachers. Mm-hmm. Access that. So how do we do that? And, you know, when you look at, I often look when I walk into a cafeteria and I see that we've replaced the furniture in it, we've got the cafe tables and the low tables, I ask, what rules apply to the cafe tables? And I often get rules like, oh, third and fifth grade kids can eat there when their parents are here to have lunch with them. Or if kids behave, then. And I'm like, you know, how do we keep that from happening? You know, so that it becomes a true choice for the kid. Not every kid's going to choose a cafe table. They might all think that they can the first couple of weeks, but some kids just aren't going to like eating there. And they'll figure that out. So how do we turn over some of that to the kids and help them? And you know, it's not a choice if they're all taken. You can't choose it. So how do we navigate that?
And that's going to be more pronounced for college faculty because you're not tied to the room in the same way, right?
Right.
It's not your room. Yet at the same time, that need to feel control over the space. So
right.
I mean, so the challenge then becomes designing the space. I think is to be able to make it so that people understand what you can do with it, or they can see what it can be done with it, even if it's not the way it was for them before, they can use in different ways, and that's okay. They can give up a degree of that control. And if you can do that, then it can create something much more dynamic.
How intensive were your trainings with professors about, you know, marine technology,
very,
and how to integrate it with
them? Very, and that was part of that was a real part of the key, because the existing staff was part of the staff was really resistant to that, and we were moving much more from here's you do the training, so we're going to have an Excel workshop today, to much more of this sort of digital pedagogy, instructional technology. So we were able to bring in people from Knightley. And so it becomes that people are much more, faculty are much more resistant to talking to someone who's like an instructional technologist coming out of a place like Curry, but they're much more willing to hear about it from other faculty members. So the trick was getting that in there, spreading it sideways. You know, I was a big fan of the Battlestar Galactica show, and our president teased me. He said, well, you're just a silent. It's okay, I'm a silent too, right? And so that partly, it's that spreading it among faculty in that sort of horizontal way, and that, you know, good space is, you know, it starts changing what you do. And that can be, it's scary, but it's a good thing.
So I'm mindful of the time, and I think this is a great place to not wrap up, but dot, dot, dot. I think it's kind of goes full circle, this idea of even keeping these conversations open and fluid, and maybe this is the first of a number of opportunities where outside of a project we can break down our silos and we'll come there and have big group hugs and talk about this some more. I feel like we're just starting to get into the meat of the matter. So we are learning new ways to design processes that include you early on. I think that's, you know, teachers and students as a part of the process is critical. And then not waiting for a project to collaborate, even if it's in this format and a little more fluid. So, but thank you so much. You've really encouraged us, inspired us, and now we know who to call.